of the great Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. He was the fourth Caliph in Islam, and he took over from Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu anhu. He was born in Makkah al-Mukarramah, and he was approximately 30 years younger than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Something interesting is, the man who looked after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam after the death of his grandfather was the father of Ali, who was known as Abu Talib. This Abu Talib was the uncle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who defended Islam and the Muslims, but he did not accept Islam himself. And he had a son known as Ali ibn Abi Talib. That was Ali, the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They had a very, very good relation from a very young age. And the reason is, Abu Talib went through some difficult time in his life. And there was a time when he could not afford to look after his children. So he decided to take two of the three children he had to his relatives. So he took one to Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, who was his brother. And he told him, would you look after one of my children? So Al-Abbas says, I will look after Ja'far. Ja'far ibn Abi Talib. And he then approached Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and told him, would you look after one of my children? And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, I will look after Ali ibn Abi Talib. And Ali radiyallahu anhu, his age was approximately 5 to 6 years old when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam began to take care of him. So he grew up with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha. So when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was granted prophethood by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ali ibn Abi Talib, who loved him so much, was the first from amongst the boys to accept Islam. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu was the first from amongst the men. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu was the first from amongst the boys to accept Islam. And how exactly it happened, there are two versions, but both of them are quite similar in their narration. The one says that Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Khadija binti Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha reading salah, meaning worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he asked Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what are you doing? So he said, I am worshipping Allah who made me, and I do not worship the idols. The idols are wrong. It is wrong to do what Quraysh is doing. And he explained to him what Islam was, and he invited him to Islam. And Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu accepted the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. One narration says, he said, let me talk to my father. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, you've got to think. If you would like, you accept it, but I'd like you to keep it to yourself for now, because I've not been instructed yet to go and tell the others. And no sooner was that said, a little while later, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu accepted Islam. Then one of the famous stories in the life of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was the story at the time of the hijrah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he was migrating to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. That night, the kuffar of Quraysh, the disbelievers, had plotted to kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They actually sent people to encircle the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to let Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu lay in his bedding. Amazing. This was something that would have put the life of someone at risk, because these people were planning to kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They could have stormed the house and attacked the person in the bedding, believing that it was the bedding of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But here, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu immediately agreed, and he was the one on the bedding of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that night. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam left the home, they did not even know that he is no longer in the house. They saw the bedding and they said, he is still there, not realizing that it was Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. The following day, when they started to find out who was in the bedding, they realized it was actually Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. So this was one of the great sacrifices that were made by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu at the time of the hijrah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. My brothers and sisters, there came a time, the second year after the hijrah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, wherein Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was married to the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, known as Fatima binti Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what exactly happened? Well, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, "O Ali, what do you have? You want to marry my daughter, but what do you have to give her in terms of a mahr?" Now, you and I would know that mahr is not a dowry in every sense of the meaning of the term dowry. It is a gift that is given from the groom to the bride. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew that this man does not own a home. He's not a wealthy man. He doesn't have much. But he gave him his daughter. The daughter of the greatest of all, Fatima binti Muhammad radiyallahu anha. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved his daughter so much. Do you think he would have given his daughter to someone who really had absolutely nothing? According to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ali ibn Abi Talib had a lot. He had iman. He was an upright youngster. He grew up with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So his character and his religion were of a very, very high level, if not one of the highest. If someone comes to marry your daughter, they have good character and conduct and a high level of deen, let them get married. Subhanallah. Let them get married. From this we learn that those who choose to look at wealth and wealth alone and status in society and status alone, a lot of the times they doom their daughters into great depression. Yet they just want to save their names. That's why they got them married there. May Allah protect us. It's not always the case, but it is happening more often today than ever before. May Allah grant us the ability to seek guidelines from the messenger we claim to love so much. Here is he. This is what he did with Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, "Oh Ali, what do you have?" He says, "I have nothing." He says, "Oh Ali, you have an armor. The armor that you have, what about that?" He said, "Yes, I do have the armor." He said, "Well, you can sell the armor and give the amount to my daughter." So he did not say, "Pay me for my daughter and you need to pay the rest of my family and bring gifts and we need to have a night before you get married that will be even bigger than the marriage itself and we need to start celebrating in this way and that way." It was something so simple. He said, "Oh Ali, that is the dirah, that is the armor. I have now married you to my daughter and that will be the mahar. That will be the amount that you will give as a gift to my own daughter." They were married and the ceremony was not even what we would see today. It was something that was an agreement between them. They had the witnesses that were there. Simple occasion. And this was one of the most blessed of all marriages ever. May Allah grant us ease. So listen to what Ali ibn Abi Talib did. He went out to the market to sell his armor. So Uthman ibn Affan, who was married to the other daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these are now brothers-in-law, right? So he says, "Oh Ali, what are you doing?" He says, "I'm here to sell my dirah, to sell my armor, because I am about to marry the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Fatima." Uthman was so happy. He said, "Can I pay you for it? What do you want?" He says, "I want 400 dirhams. He says, "Okay, no problem. Here is the 400. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. He paid him a certain amount. Some say 400, some say 480. Little gold coins. So that would be dananir, dinars. So what happened is, he paid him the amount, and when he took the armor, and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu took the amount, Uthman ibn Affan calls him back and says, "Oh Ali, this is a gift from me to you. Here is an armor. You can have this." Subhanallah. So he went back with the armor and with the 400 as well. Subhanallah. And he went to give it and he told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about what Uthman ibn Affan had done. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so delighted and so happy. Imagine, these were now family members related to one another. They had big hearts. May Allah grant us ease. Today, a father will not help his own son with 400 gold coins. Believe me. Today, people who are married to two sisters might not even want to look at each other. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. This was the love between Uthman and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh. They were brothers-in-law and they loved each other from the very beginning. In fact, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh, there was so much of love between him and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh, that during the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu used to be seen walking with him a lot of the times. And when Al-Hasan, who is the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, when he used to be a little child, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq used to take him and put him up on his shoulder and walk with him and play with him. This was the relationship they had. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a good relationship. So, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he was also from amongst one of those who have been enlisted as al-Asharah, the ten. The ten who were told, you are from paradise. His name was the fourth name. Amazing. His name was the fourth name. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them all. So he was also one of them in the same circle of people who were already told that you are from amongst those in paradise. Bear in mind, he was approximately 30 years younger than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which makes him approximately 28 years younger than Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He was quite young. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, he had the honor of doing the ghusl, or the washing of the body, the blessed body of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was one of those, being the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and also his son-in-law at the same time. So if we take a look at the children of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu from Fatima radiallahu anha, from amongst them were two who were very, very well known, Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn. So the marriage occurred the second year of Hijrah, the third year Al-Hasan was born, and the fourth year Al-Husayn was born. Radiallahu anhum jami'an. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased upon all of them. So Ali ibn Abi Talib was known as Katibu Wahyi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was one who used to write the revelation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to write the Quran. Then if we take a careful look at Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, we've spoken about it in the last few days, the treaty of Hudaybiyah that had happened. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu and told him, write, I'd like you to write. I would like you to write the following. And the treaty was actually written by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and he was one of the witnesses of that particular treaty. When it comes to the battle of Khaybar, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in Khaybar that tomorrow, in the night he spoke, and he said, tomorrow I will give the flag, I will give the leadership to one whom Allah loves and who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So at night people were actually thinking, who are they going to speak about? At night they were thinking, who are they going to speak about? And they found, subhanallah, that in the morning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Aina Ali ibn Abi Talib? Where is Ali, the son of Abu Talib? And immediately they knew that this man, Allah loves him and he loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he called Ali and he says, oh Ali, say the name of Allah and enter into this Khaybar, enter into this fort of Khaybar, and remember the famous statement of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remember that if Allah guides through you one single person, it is better for you than the most valuable of the camels that we have. You know, the top of conveyance at the time was the red camel, very expensive. Today I wonder what we could say. Could we say perhaps an S-Class Mercedes-Benz, S650 or something of that nature? Well, everyone has a different liking. But the truth is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, it's better for you to guide one person to what is right than to have anything material that this world can offer you. My brothers and sisters, let's stop there because it's important for us to learn a lesson. This was at the time of war. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling Ali, don't just go around killing people. No, guide them, teach them. If they are guided through your effort, it is better for you. Imagine. Today you have people in the name of Islam going around killing people and saying we are following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's very, very sad, subhanallah, how people do not learn from this beautiful statement of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, wallahi, O Ali, you know, don't just be trigger happy. Learn to spread the guidance. Remember to go out and guide the people. Some people look at non-Muslims and say these are the enemies of Islam, whereas we are taught that you look at the non-Muslims and say these are all potential Muslims. Somewhere up the ladder, our forefathers were non-Muslim as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us to spread the deen. At the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu as well, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was one of those who pledged allegiance. They had such a powerful relation. Can I inform you how powerful this relation was? When Ali ibn Abi Talib, mashallah, he had many children and he married multiple wives after the death of Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, She passed away approximately 6 months after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She was the last of the children of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to pass away, because all of his children passed away in his lifetime sallallahu alaihi wasallam, besides Fatima. Fatima radiallahu anha passed away approximately 6 months later. After that, Ali ibn Abi Talib married the widow of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Now, if they were enemies, why would he do that? Secondly, he looked after the child of Abu Bakr as his own child. His name was Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. He was the son of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq from Asma binti Umays. And Asma binti Umays radiallahu anha was married to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu after the death of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. How powerful. And after that, he named his children as follows. One of them was Abu Bakr ibn Ali. The other one was Umar ibn Ali. The other one was Uthman ibn Ali radiallahu anhum. But people don't tell us this, do they? These were some of the children of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He had a son known as Abu Bakr ibn Ali. He had a son known as Umar ibn Ali. Do you know this? May Allah's peace and blessings be upon them all. So this was the love that they had amongst each other. But there came people later on who created dispute and who created discord. This is what we spoke about yesterday, and we said, my brothers and sisters, be careful of people who come to you to create discord between you and your brethren in faith. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Ali radiallahu anhu lost his armor at one stage when he was the Amir. And so when he went to Kufa, he found a Jewish man selling this armor. He looked at it and he said, hey, this is my armor. The Jewish man says, no, it's mine. I'm selling it. It's in my hands. So he said, no, let's go to the Qadi. Now the Qadi was known as Shurayh. Shurayh was a powerful Qadi based in Kufa. He was appointed by Ali. Appointed by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu an. Confirmed by him, although he was there from prior to his time. But Ali ibn Abi Talib went and sat right next to the Qadi. And the Jewish man was in front. And he says, oh Shurayh, this man has my armor. So Shurayh says, oh Amirul Mu'mineen, we need some form of evidence to prove that it is yours. So he says, here are my sons, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn. Those who are companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will bear witness that this armor is mine. So Shurayh says, I am very sorry. O Amirul Mu'mineen, with all due respect, a child cannot bear witness for his own father here according to the law of Islam. So I will have to rule that this armor belongs to the Jewish man. The Jewish man was stunned. He was shocked to the degree that he said, I am so shocked. This is Amirul Mu'mineen, the leader who ruled so many lands, and he is sitting here in front of a Qadi that is under him, and he has just given me this armor. He says, no ways. I bear witness that this is the true deen. I bear witness that Allah is one and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the messenger. Immediately he accepted Islam. This was an incident that had occurred at the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anh. He was happy. He did not get upset with Shurayh and say, I appointed you, now you can leave. And he did not make life difficult. That was a judge. He was independent and he spoke the truth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. The son of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was asked a question. That in fact, he asked his father, Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, who was the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he asked his father, who is the best of people after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So his father said, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, subhanallah. So the son says, and who next? He says, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Now, the son was worried that, hey, I need my father's name somewhere. So he said, what about you, O my father? He says, Ma ana illa rajulun min al-Muslimin. He says, I am just a man from amongst the Muslims. This is how humble he was. This is how modest he was. He says, I am just a Muslim. Yet, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told him, O Ali, you are from amongst those who already have paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and bless them all. I want to make mention of one last major point that has moved me. He used to read Salah at night, every single night. And he used to fast a lot in terms of voluntary fasts. So the people asked him, O Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, you are a man, you know that you are from paradise, yet you are standing at night and you are fasting every day. What is it? So he looks at them and he says, the journey to the life after, meaning the journey into paradise, is a very long journey. You need to travel towards it by night. Listen to this. You need to travel towards it by night. Wallahi, this has moved me. By night, if you are fast asleep all the time, your journey to paradise is going to be made more difficult. You really want to travel into paradise? Well, you better start traveling by making that journey at night. Stand up in salah for Allah. My brothers and sisters, I hope that can motivate myself and yourselves to read at least our taraweeh correctly and to get up at least for tahajjud whilst we are busy eating for suhoor. Do you know it is the time of tahajjud? I would suggest we take a moment to at least start traveling towards paradise by using that time, even if it means to engage in two units of salah, two raka'at of salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was martyred. He was martyred when he was approximately 63 years old, the 40th year of Hijrah, by a man known as Abdul Rahman ibn Muljim. He was a man who was dead against Ali ibn Abi Talib. One might ask, why were they against Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu? One simple reason: when Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu was murdered, the people were divided into two groups. One of them remained with Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, who did not seek to penalize the murderers immediately, but he sought to deal with them in a different way. And the others had sought the penalization of those who murdered Uthman immediately. They said, "Oh Ali, you as an Amir need to penalize those who have murdered Uthman immediately." So this was the difference of opinion primarily, as what to do exactly with those who have murdered Uthman ibn Affan. Should we deal with them now, or should we deal with them as time passes? It was actually an issue that divided the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. It resulted in two major groups: those who were with Ali ibn Abi Talib, those who actually were against what he was doing. But at the same time, there were other disgruntled people. One of them was Abdul Rahman ibn Muljim. He bought a sword and he put on that sword a lot of poison, and he sliced the belly of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, or he actually pierced him with that particular sword with the poison that he had put on it. And Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu passed away 3 days later. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this type of fitna. Really, people from amongst the Muslimin killing one another, this is what has caused destruction from the very beginning. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us.